Hey, everybody. I'm Scott Weichel. You're listening to My Kind of Country. Thanks for joining us on a Monday night. My guest tonight has been on my show before, and we had the best conversation. And I'm very honored that he took the time to do the show again tonight because he's got a lot more great stories. He's a four-time Grammy Award winner. As a musician, he has played on so many fabulous country music recordings over the years, and he's produced tons and tons of them, including Tammy Wynette, Stand By Your Man, Harper Valley PTA. The list just goes on and on. And he's got so much great country music history, and I'm so thankful that he's taken time to share it with me tonight. It's an honor to welcome Jerry Kennedy to My Kind of Country. Jerry, how are you tonight?
Doing great, Scott, and I am glad to be here with you. And how are you doing?
I am doing fantastic, and I just can't thank you enough for taking the time. I was honored you did one interview, and now you're doing another, and I really appreciate that.
I don't mind being in an ear and talking about what was really good for me for a lot of years.
Well, it certainly was, and you were a lot of good for country music. My playlist would be a lot shorter if it wasn't for the hands of Jerry Kennedy, you know?
and a lot of other people, Scott. I was part of a big team down here.
The magic that happened out of Nashville is second to none and can never be duplicated again. That's an era that'll never come back again. But you know what? That music's always going to live on.
I agree. And, isn't it great to listen to it? I bet all those records that we were involved with back then seem to hold up now.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. You know, and I'm always amazed. I hear a lot of singers nowadays that are doing traditional country, and they're going back and redoing these songs, and they're finding songs that were, you know, maybe album tracks that got overlooked, and they're just great songs. And as a DJ, I mean, I'll never run out of material. There is so much great music, not only the hits, but you start listening to these albums, and there are some fabulous songs on there, you know?
People don't realize what gold those songs are too. I mean, that's the magic. That's where the magic starts.
You are absolutely right. And I want to thank our mutual friend and family friend, Margie Singleton, for getting us in touch, and just think the world of her and love her so much. And I know she just loves you too, and I'm so glad that she got us together.
I love her. She's been like a sister to me for a lot of years, so.
Well, she wanted me to ask you about a country music show that you did in New York on Broadway. She said, ask Jerry about that. So that's my first question to you tonight.
Oh, boy. Now, that would be something that we did. I think I know what she's talking about. It was a show called All American, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, yeah.
And we didn't do it. We tried to stay away from New York making records, but we did the soundtrack here in Nashville. So it really didn't, we didn't have anything to do with being on Broadway with that project, if that's the one she's talking about. And it has to be because it's the only one I had anything to do with.
So you recorded the music right in Nashville for that?
Yeah, we did all those sessions here. Sure did.
Well, we covered a lot of ground last time, but it came to me that there was a lot of artists that I really didn't get into and talk to you about, and one of them is one of my very favorites, and his recordings on the Smash label to me were the very best that he ever did, and that's Charlie Rich.
You know, God, what a great thing it was to be able to work with Charlie. You know, so many of the artists I work with, and we may have touched on this back then, were heroes before I ever got involved with them. And Lonely Weekends was absolutely one of my favorite records by Charlie Rich.
Yeah, me too.
I had heard that, you know, this guy, his talent went way beyond that, and sure enough, I ran into that a few times when we were talking to him about doing some sessions here. And I loved work. I think I did two albums with Charlie here. Uh-huh. And loved every minute of it. What a talent. He really stepped out after 4 or 5 years later. Hopefully we kind of opened the door for him a little bit. But when he and Billy Sherrill made some records together that were awesome.
Oh, absolutely. But you made some.
And Closed Door, Beautiful Girl, Most Beautiful Girl. I don't know. There was some magic about those two records for sure.
Well, I tell you, you recorded some great stuff with him. You know, you mentioned Lonely Weekends and, you know, Mohair Sam and Wash My Hands in Muddy Water. I mean, it was just gold.
those were fun. That was a fun date. There were a lot of firsts, I think, done on that. Jerry Kerrigan, a drummer that I had worked with in the Muscle Shoals on a couple of dates, had moved to Nashville, and those were Jerry's first sessions here in town.
Oh, wow.
And we were having a lot of fun. And Mohair Sam, you mentioned, the girl singing the harmony with Charlie on that title line, Fast Talking, Slow Walking, Good Looking Mohair Sam, is Prissy Reed, Jerry Reed's wife.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Prissy was a great background singer. We used her a lot. And in fact, she had a hit record with Roy Drusky, Priscilla Mitchell and Roy Drusky, on a thing called Yes, Mr. Peters. I don't know if you remember that.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Yep.
Yeah.
You did a bunch of recording with Roy Drusky, too, right?
I sure did. Loved every minute of that, too. What a great guy he was, man. It was a fabulous man to work with.
Oh, that's wonderful. I know that Charlie Rich was a fabulous piano player. Did he play piano on his recordings when you recorded with him?
The two albums I did with him, he played all the piano. Yeah, he had all the piano parts.
Wow. Now, I talked to Ralph Emery a while back, and we were talking about interviews and such, and he said that Charlie Rich was a real hard guy to interview because he was so quiet. Did you find that to be the case when you were recording with him?
Very much so, except when we got gathered around that piano, he seemed to open up and it just flowed out of him. Scott, it was really kind of funny. But I could meet with him and have lunch, you know, the day of the sessions that night or whatever, you know, and he was, yes, no, whatever, you know, and just real quiet, like Ralph said, very quiet, and not saying much. But when we got to the place and the fire was being stoked and we were fixing to light it up, man, here he came, and he just opened up, and all of the what he had wanted to say all day had just poured out.
Make it all right from Monday morning to Friday night. But oh, those lonely weekends since you left me, I'm as lonely as I can be. But oh, those lonely weekends, you said that you'd be good to me. said our love should never die. Said you'd be true to me. But baby, you didn't even try. Well, I make it all right from Monday morning to Friday night. But oh, this lonely weekend. Monday morning to Friday night. But oh, those lonely weekends. Oh, those lonely weekends. Oh,
those lonely
weekends.
Hello?
Hello, dear. Will the same place be all right?
Yes, indeed, Mr. Peters, I can work late tonight.
Dear, is she near? Can she hear what you say?
You're right, Mr. Peters, and I'm leaving right away.
Are you sure she's not listening on the other line?
No, of course not, Mr. Peters. You can call me anytime.
What if she knows just where you go?
Don't worry, Mr. Peters, 'cause my wife don't mind at all.
Please hurry up, dear, 'cause I'm so in love with you.
I know exactly how you feel, 'cause I feel the same way too.
Tell me, dear, how much longer must we live this life?
I don't know, Mr. Peters, but I should be there by 9.
Well, don't be late. I can't wait to be with you once more.
Don't worry, Mr. Peters, I'm just heading for the door. Well, yes, Mr. Peters, I'm just heading for the door.
Farron Young is another one that that we didn't talk about last time, and I know you did a whole lot of work with him.
I did. Farron was, Farron was a friend before we ever left Shreveport. I met Farron probably when I was 10 or 11. He was 15 or 16 in Shreveport before he started. Was it a Gotham label? I can't remember. I think Gotham Records that he had a record on. And I remember him playing it in a music store for a bunch of us kids. We all followed Farron around, you know, when he would come downtown, and we were all down at this one particular music store, J&S Music in Shreveport. And they had these little booths where you could go in and listen to records, you know, and he had an acetate on a session that he'd done. And I remember all of us packed into this one little booth that was probably for two people. But there was Farron and probably 8 or 10 of us kids back in there listening to his record. I remember that vividly. Anyway, he was a good friend before we ever left Shreveport. And it was a thrill for me to be... Shelby Singleton actually signed him to Mercury. And it was a thrill for me to inherit him when Shelby left the label, and I was able to jump in there and help him do some really great stuff. And he was... what a great song guy, and that's always some magic right there.
I know he was kind of a colorful guy. I've heard a lot of stories about him. Do you have any favorite Farron Young stories you can share with me?
Probably none that we can tell on radio. Farron was the more loose of the bunch that I ever worked with. Farron loved to party and have a good time. That was what he was all about when he wasn't working. And that was the way he rolled. And that was fine. But when it came session time, there was a whole different person, man. He was dead serious and everything was cool. And, you know, none of that came into the studio, and we were on the same page, no problem.
Well, he had a lot of great hits on Mercury. I know, you know, Wind Me Up, and It's 4 in the Morning. That's a classic. And
yeah, gosh, that was you know, that was a big record in England. I don't know if a lot of people know that or not, but it was huge over there. Mm-hmm. And he was, I remember there was a little dust up on that song. Farron didn't want to do it in waltz time. And that was the only hit button that we had when he was at Mercury, but it didn't last very long. We talked him into doing it in waltz time, because it belonged in waltz time. That was where that song felt great. He said waltzes didn't hit, and I told him it's too bad Jim Reeves wasn't alive for him to ask that.
That's right.
But he'll have to go.
Yeah, that's right. Ernest Tubb too. Waltz Across Texas. There was a lot of good. Hello, Darling. There's another one. You know.
Yeah, there's been a ton of them.
Yeah, he was great. Now, I know you produced the lion's share of his stuff. Did you play on a lot of his records too?
I did. You know, and most of the time, and most of the record, and we may have touched on this, I would play afterwards. I found it was kind of difficult for me to sit out in the room and play something and then have to, you know, go in and listen to it, as opposed to saving time by being in the control room listening to it as it was going down and doing my part later. But that probably would have been the way that I did them with Farron. Now, there were like the Statlers and Jerry Lee's, a couple of other things. I loved being out in the room, doing it with the guys. That's what I always loved. Scott, I worked with a room full of geniuses, man, whenever all those players came in there, and we would all sit around, and they made this old guitar player sound so good, man. I mean, it was just unbelievable. It was hard not to just sit and grin when all that music was going on around me.
It's 4 in the morning. And once more the dawning just woke up the wanting in me. Wishing I'd never met her, knowing if I'd forget her, how much better off she would be. The longer I hold on and the longer this goes on, the harder that it's gonna be. But it's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the wanting in me. I never deserved her, God knows when I hurt her, that's the last thing that I want to do. She tries, but she can't tell how she feels, but I know too well what she's going through. If I love her so much, I don't know why I can't do the right thing and just let her be. it's 4 in the morning, and what's more, the dawning just woke up the warning in me. Last night I told her this time it's all over, making 10 times I told her goodbye. Last night we broke up, this morning I woke up, and for the 10th time I'm changing my mind. I saw more love in her eyes when I left her than most foolish men will ever see. And it's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the warning in me. It's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the warning in me. Wishing I
center of attention in this barroom, 'cause I've got the biggest heartache of the year. And each night those swinging doors reach out for me and draw me in. I'll say no each night that I'll come back to wind me up again. Wind me up, turn me on, and watch me cry for you. Lately drinking warm red wine is all I want to do. And I never know how tight I'll wind me up till I walk in. But I don't care, 'cause I'll be back to wind me up again. Thank the men that raised the grapes way out in California, and I'm hoping this will be their biggest year. All scarlet water's all that's left to keep me hanging on, and that's why I'll try to wind me up each day and night next year. Wind me up, turn me on, and watch me cry for you. Lately drinking warm red wine is all I want to do. And I never know how tight I'll wind me up till I walk in. But I don't care, 'cause I'll be back to wind me up again.
Now, who were some of the main musicians that you worked with at that time?
Well, when we first came to town, there wasn't much of a pool to pick from. We had what I call the Harold Ray Buddy Bob Pig thing. It was Harold Bradley, Ray Eddington, Buddy Harmon, Bob Moore, and Pig Robbins. Now, if you got those five guys, that was a great nucleus to start with, you know. And then we would bring in Boots Randolph, Charlie McCoy, and then later on, I added Chip Young to the rhythm guitar thing. Pete Wade brought him in playing electric. And we used Floyd Kramer some on piano. I loved Pig's playing more, because Pig had a heavier left hand, and I loved that, man. Listen to some of Jerry Lee's records, and that old left hand is almost pounding that piano through the floor.
Yeah.
Anyway, it was just, I don't know. That if you got those guys, you started there, and then you could bring in some people. And then later on, we had bass players that moved to town, Henry Strelecki. And Charlie McCoy was a great electric bass player. Junior Husky. And the piano, Bill Purcell was another piano player who was really good. And guitar player, Wayne Moss. Listening to the instrumental on Only Daddy That'll Walk the Line sometime. That's Wayne playing that turnaround, man. That's awesome. There were a drummer, Buddy Harmon, was the guy, but then we brought in, like I said, Jerry Kerrigan and Kenny Buttrey. I don't want to bore you with all these people. You know, these are probably people that folks have only seen their names on the backs of albums. But there were some great players here beginning about 1964 and 5. We didn't have to worry about being able to pull in a good group for a session. And as opposed to 61 and 62, you know, if you couldn't get so-and-so or this one or that one, you had to wait and do your session later. Mm-hmm. And that was also when the rooms started being built in Nashville, too. This new studios were opening up about that time also.
Sure, sure. Well, these people, to me, are every bit as important as the artists because they were building their sound. And in many cases, you were creating a whole new sound for these artists that stayed with them through their careers. And
it sure did. And they don't get enough credit for that, as far as I'm concerned. I wish they would have this mass induction into the Hall of Fame and put all those players in there.
Yeah, yeah.
But that'll never happen.
You know, I've had some wonderful conversations with a lot of these wonderful session players. On, you know, Jimmy Capps comes to mind. I had a great conversation with him.
Yeah, and hey, I neglected to mention Jimmy. Pardon me. I worked with so many wonderful, talented people, man. It's just hard to remember all of them.
Well, going back to Jerry Lee for just a minute, I know we talked about him last time, but I wanted to get a little more in-depth with him in the studio and what it was mm-hmm. like recording with Jerry Lee Lewis.
That was, like I say, that I can remember, and I may have told this story before, hanging on a jukebox when I was 17, 18 years old, listening to a whole lot of Shakes Going On and Great Balls of Fire and Breathless and all that stuff, and just loving what I was hearing. And all of a sudden, coming to, you know, gosh, it was like a whirlwind with all of us moving up here and going to work, and then Shelby Singleton coming in, and, hey, I've signed Jerry Lee Lewis. We take, you know, he's going to be here, and that was a big thrill. And I can't remember some of the things we did with him, but it just wasn't, and we probably covered this earlier, it wasn't happening until we started doing the country stuff, thanks to an old disc jockey over in Knoxville who just bothered me until we did it. And, gosh, it was great. Turned out to be great.
Well, I think Jerry Lee loved to do country music. You know,
Yeah. Well, he was so comfortable doing country. It seemed like it was the natural thing. You know, why hadn't we done that 8 or 9 years earlier? You know?
Yeah. Now, was he another one that played piano on his sessions?
It did, and on some of them. Some of them he would get off and let Pig Robbins do the piano. Mm-hmm. And it would depend on something that he felt comfortable playing and singing. Or not, and when I could tell a little bit, you know, when he was a little shy about when he would sit down, and he would start fooling with, you know, trying to make it work, and I'd say, you know, hey, you want to let Pig play this one? You concentrate on the vocal, and yeah, and no problem at all. He'd jump right up and let Pig sit down. I can't remember. There weren't a lot of them, but there were some that he relinquished his piano, and hey. That would be a good way to put it, because man, did he ever own it when he sat down and played one. It was a thing of beauty to watch.
Morning's come, and Lord, my mind is aching. Yes, it is. Sunshine standing quietly at my door. just like the dawn. My heart is silently breaking. With my tears, it goes coming to the floor. Once again, the whole town will be talking. Yes, they will. Lord, I've seen the pity that's in their eyes. They can never understand. It's her sorrow, it's not a man. And no matter what they say, we know she tried. She's left me, and I know she didn't mean to make me cry. It's not her heart, Lord, it's her mind. She didn't mean to be unkind. Why she even woke me up to say goodbye. It's not her heart, Lord, it's her mind. She didn't mean to be unkind. Why she even woke me up to say
everything's fine. All them cats is drinking that wine, drinking that mist of pure delight. And when they get drunk, they singing all night, drinking wine, spooty ooty, drinking wine. Wine, spooty ooty, drinking wine. Wine, spooty ooty, drinking wine. Pass that bottle to me. They buying it by the gallon and buying by the quart. Buy a blackberry, you're doing things smart. Knocking out windows and tearing down doors. Drunk, 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 keep a screaming for more. Drinking wine, spooty ooty, drinking wine. Wine, spooty ooty, drinking wine. Wine, spooty ooty, drinking wine. Why don't you pass that bottle to me? Yeah. Take it, take it, take it. sang about it.
And we had talked about Johnny Rodriguez, and you had produced Pass Me By, which was a huge hit for him. What was it like working with him in the studio?
You know, he was that kid off the street corner, you know, that you signed. I mean, you know, you could almost, if you did a story, except he came through the door with, if I remember right, Bobby Bear and Tom T. Hall telling us that he was, and Roy Day signed Johnny. And then Roy had a chance to go to RCA and produce records over there right as we were beginning to do Rodriguez. So Roy and I co-produced Pass Me By. And then Roy was gone, and I inherited Johnny. What a talent. And he was so naive, we could tell him anything and he'd buy it. And just little things like, I know the engineer would tease him about, you know, listen to your voice here. And then Johnny would crawl towards the speaker, and Tom would pan the voice over to the other speaker. Well, he wouldn't put, you know, like what happened. He would run over to the other speaker and listen, and Tom would pan it back to the one where he started. And he had running back forward like he was in a tennis match or something. Things like that. There was a device on a tape machine that if you hit it, it took the tape up a quarter tone. And he could be sitting out in the studio singing, gonna sing harmony, and when it got to where he came in, we could hit that button, and all of a sudden he was flat. And he knew it immediately, man. He would just look at us like he'd been shot, you know. But anyway, we had a lot of fun with him. He was very naive, but what a talent, man. He could sing.
You were a session musician for Bob Dylan's Blonde on Blonde record, too. Is that right?
Yeah, I was. One or two sessions. You know, I played all night one night. And Bob Johnson was his producer, and Bob had called me and asked me if I would work it, and I, you know, Bob Dylan, gosh, you know, I said sure, but I said I can't do those all-nighters, man. I'm producing things on my, you know, for Mercury during the daytime here, and it was kind of like that when I had worked some with Elvis, I couldn't work all night and then expect to do decent work the next day. Anyway, I worked all night one night with Bob Dylan, and that was the only time I played. And it turned out to be a bunch of stuff that went on the Blonde on Blonde project.
You know, I know Bob did a lot of recording in Nashville, and he's always had kind of, you know, ties with country music. He's kind of been on the outskirts of that, and seems like it was right. Kind of a natural fit for him.
Yeah, it was. I know that he really did enjoy the dates here. I've heard him interviewed. I've seen things in writing where he had fun. That's what those were about.
Yeah, absolutely. Did you also work with Kris Kristofferson?
I did. I cut some of Chris's first things here. This is a real quick little story, but I was in the studio one night with Roy Gusky, and we had done a 10 p.m. session, which I hate those things, but, you know, sometimes that's what you had to do in order to finish up an album project, get it done on time, whatever. And anyway, we're sitting there, and we're listening to the playback that we had done on 10. This would have been at 1 o'clock. Sessions were 3 hours. And when the songs died down and we were sitting there and Roy and I were talking about what we were going to be doing, I think it was either the next night or 2 nights later. And this voice from over and behind the scale, I can write better songs than that. And I looked over and it's the guy who's cleaning up the studio. And anyway, I said, well, do it. And he said, where can I come to play you some songs? I told him. He came over the next morning and played us one or two things, and I think we did them both that night. Jody and the Kid was one of them, and I can't remember what the other one was now. But anyway, it was supposedly some of the first things that Chris had cut here.
Wow.
And anyway, we turned out to be buddies. I did the first record on For the Good Times.
Oh, wow.
A guy named Bill Nash out of Houston, Texas. And in fact, on that same session, I think we did Help Me Make It Through the Night also with Bill.
Oh, my gosh.
But For the Good Times went out there, and it was 345 or 350, I remember, Scott, and Mercury. Had they used more energy, we might have had a big hit record with Bill, but they used the excuse that it was too long. I mean, they were getting some feedback from radio that it was too long, and it was a good while later that Ray Price cut it. Mm-hmm. And I guess there was some forgiveness that went with longer records, you know, over a period of time. But, you know, for a long while, you didn't really get over 230, 240. You were here in radio. You knew what we went through.
Yeah, absolutely.
You could get a little too long with some of those things, and they wouldn't play them.
Yeah, it didn't happen often. I know El Paso comes to mind. That was one that that came up through there and blew that away.
Somebody told the story was, you know, that was what they shipped out, an edited version that they started getting back. They said, no, man, you know, that ruined it. We'll play the long version.
This old highway seems so lonesome when you're going where you've been, and a lonesome song can make you cry time and time again. If I had listened to a friend of mine 10 years ago today, I'd have a better job than what I got today. But the billboards on the highways and the brake lights on the cars make me jump out on the highway with my bag and my guitar. If she comes or if she goes, it doesn't matter anymore, 'cause I'm riding my thumb to Mexico. Riding my thumb to Mexico. It don't matter when or how I go. I'll ride this thumb till I see her again. So I'm riding my thumb to Mexico. Well, the reason why she left me's not the reason that I'm here. I'm a traveling kind of man, just need a change of atmosphere. If there's any place I haven't been at all, that's where I'll go. So I'm riding my thumb to Mexico. Riding my thumb to Mexico. It don't matter when or how I go. I'll ride this thumb till I see her again. So I'm riding my thumb to Mexico.
She would meet me in the morning on my way down to the river, waiting patient by the chanoberry tree. With her feet already dusty from the pathway to the levee, and her little blue jeans rolled up to her knees. I'd pay her no attention as she tagged along beside me, trying hard to copy everything I did. But I couldn't keep from smiling when I'd hear somebody saying, "Look yonder, there goes Jody and the kid." Even after we grew older, still be seen together as we walked along the levee holding hands. For as surely as the seasons, she was changing to a woman, and I lived enough to call myself a man. And she often lay beside me in the coolness of the evening, till the morning sun was shining on my bed. And at times when she was sleeping, I would smile when I'd remember how they used to call us Jody and the Kid. Now the world's a little older, and the years have changed the river, 'cause there's houses where they didn't used to be. And on Sundays I go walking down the pathway to the levee with another little girl who follows me. And it makes the old folks smile to see her tag along beside me, doing little things the way her mama did. But it gets a little lonesome when I hear somebody saying, "Look yonder, there goes Jody and the Kid."
Tell me about Dave Dudley.
Dave was another inherited, you know, an artist I inherited. Shelby signed him to Mercury, and gosh, Jimmy Key, I had a lot of love. But Jimmy was the manager for Dave and Tom T. During that time. He was partners with Jimmy Newman in a publishing company, and they called it New Keys Music. It was Jimmy Key and Jimmy Newman. Anyway, Dave was part of the, you know, Jimmy's deal, and like I said, I inherited. And what was happening, Jimmy would come down, Dave would come in, and they'd bring this other guy with him who would sing some songs that he had written, and we would cut one or two here and there. And it was Tom Hall at that time. And that was actually how I ended up with Tom T. Hall, and I was still recording Dave during that time too. Big old brawny guy, man. I don't know if you ever met him or not, but he was a character, man, and he fit that truck driver image. They loved him out there.
He sure had a monster hit with 6 Days on the Road, and I always liked Pool Shark. I like that song real well.
Gosh, man, he had some good ones. Pool Shark was a big, wasn't that a Tom T song?
I believe he did write that, yeah. Yep, but
it was, yeah.
Yep,
was.
Dave had a big hit with that in the early 70s there. Yep. Yeah.
He said, "Pardon me for being so bold, but you got a cigarette that's already rolled." I gave him one, he lit it in his own good time. The smoke in that pool room hung like fog. When he talked, he sounded like a growling dog. He said, "Would you care for a dollar on the 5 and the 9? Now this man was ugly and his eyes were mean. His clothes were dirty, but his hands were clean. He held that stick like a mother holds the hand of a child. Well, I've been known to hustle a few. When the waitress said, "Is he playing you?" And I said, "Yeah. Bring me brandy, water by." Little Red Parker was away in the back, taking quarters and handling racks. And I told him, "Red, come up here. Glue him up tight." That brandy had me feeling warm. I tipped that waitress and I checked her form. And I said, "Honey, you like a winner?" And she just smiled. I played like a man with a broken wrist. I won 2 and he won 6. And I had him set up, so I said, "Let's play for 5. By this time a crowd had gathered around to see this fish and just watch him drown. I told that waitress, "More brandy, water by." Then he went out and got a custom cue. He said, "It's no offense to you, but I don't play off the wall with nobody but friends. It had gold initials and a leather grip, pearl and silver inlaid tip. He smiled at me and said, "Why don't we play for 10? Well, I never seen a man that walked who made those balls and table talk. They're speaking English. He sure didn't need my help. He broke the balls and kept that string for $187 in the ring till I gave up and said, "Friend, you're gonna have to play by yourself." Well, he sacked it up and he walked outside. I strolled out just to watch him ride. There was a blind and a caddy built like the rest of that car. The boys in the pool room, they had him laughing. I hung it up and just let it pass. Didn't have a thing but my elbows to put on the bar. And the waitress smiled and said, "Waterbine." I took the charity and I thanked her twice, and sitting there sipping when suddenly I had me a thought. Unlucky gambler and lucky in love, guess you know what I was thinking of when I said, "Waitress, honey, what time do you get off?"
I know that you worked with the Statler brothers for a long time, and you worked with them well into the 80s. And were you there when they had the change in lineup when Jimmy Fortune came in?
Oh, gosh, yeah. That was, they came to me in 1970, and the last things that we did, they never did anything that I didn't produce. From 1970 on, up until we all decided that we wanted to go home. And that was, 80 or 81, 82 when that happened.
Yeah.
I think when Lou got sick and just couldn't do it anymore. And that was a sad day. But, boy, what a step in and take care of business Jimmy did, though.
Well, Jimmy has told me that Lou had chosen him to be his replacement. He's the one he wanted.
That's what I understand. And you know what was really funny is we were holding auditions here in that. When I say we, they had wanted me to be there. I guess they were, you know, wanted an opinion other than what was in that little circle. Anyway, Jimmy was the last guy that came in, and I guess it was, you know, Lou that told the guys to be sure to listen to him when they were, you know, running. And this was as a temporary replacement. And what they were going to do is when Lou felt like going on the road or whatever, you know, they'd go out there, but Jimmy would be there in the band ready to step in and play and sing. And I don't think Lou even made that first trip. It was too much for him. And Jimmy, that's how Jimmy became a brother. He's fantastic, man. And like I said, he bailed us out of the water, hot water. Just really was something that happened that was just wonderful back when he stepped in and was able to do what he did. And boy, was it a bonus when he started writing too. It was.
Oh. No, gosh.
It was just as a singer, and then all of a sudden, here are these wonderful Elizabeth and, you know, My Only Love, and all these things are pouring out, and that was great.
Oh, Elizabeth, I long to see your pretty face. I long to touch your lips. I long to feel your warm embrace. Don't know if I could ever live my life without you. Oh, Elizabeth, I'm sure
after you left Mercury Records, you had JK Productions. And,
yes.
Of course, you continued to work with the Statler Brothers, but you also worked with Connie Smith and Mel McDaniel and Reba McEntire. Tell me a little more about that. We didn't really get into those years when we talked last time.
I actually produced Reba while I was still at Mercury. But the Mel McDaniel thing, that was one of the first things I did when I fired up JK Productions. I had one foot out the door at Mercury for 2 or 3 years, I remember, and I kept trying to leave, and they kept coming up with a project here and a project there, and finally I just said, you know, like, all this stuff can be produced independently, you know. And so anyway, I felt like I was not able to do any other than Mercury projects as long as I was still at Mercury. So anyway, I had to force my way on out of there. It was really kind of a good feeling that they wanted me to hang around. But I remember that the last thing I did while I was still employed there was a Maines Brothers band, album, some guys out of Lubbock. And what a great time we had down there. And I went down there and did the album. But anyway, that was kind of like the beginning of JK Productions with Mel McDaniel. And then I did some things I really had fun with. They were Time Life. I think the original name for some of the stuff that we did, the label, was Heartland.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I did a bunch of projects for a guy named Ira Pittleman, who owned Heartland with Lawrence Welk. I think that's right. And then he sold to Time Life at some point, and then all of a sudden I was doing things for Time Life. But, you know, there was Boxcar Willie, Slim Whitman, gosh, who else did we do? Loretta Lynn. I did a gospel album with Loretta.
I remember Heartland. Now, they sold their records on television primarily.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And, you know, so did Time Life. But Heartland had a lot of TV time, you know, bought, and what he would do would be to, you know, work out what he was going to put in there later. Ira was a sharp guy. I enjoyed working with him.
So tell me a little more about Mel McDaniel. You mentioned you worked with him. What are some of the things you did with him?
Mel was a great guy to work with, man. He had definite ideas about the songs that he liked and didn't like, and I remember that with the first thing that we were taking a look at where I remember I put a whole sack full of stuff and took out to his house, and I played him some songs, and he was you know, yeah no, and we had a yes stack and a no stack, and I said, I wish you'd take that one thing out of that no stack and put it over there. And he said you know what, we'll talk about it later. And I knew then that song was in trouble. He was leaving town. He called me and asked me if I had another sack full of songs. He was going to be leaving town. He wanted to take a sack full of stuff on the bus. But I put the doggone song in that sack again by itself and sent that bag empty except for blue jeans. Baby's got a blue jeans on it. I sent it to him. And he called me from the first place he stopped on the road or whatever. And he said, I understand. I get the message. You want to do this, don't you? And I said, yeah, let's do it. And that's how we did Baby's Got a Blue Jeans On. And from that point on, Mel was always easily, you know, swayed one way or the other when I'd have songs or whatever. But we had a nice string of good records there for a while.
That was a huge hit for him. My gosh, that's great.
Yeah, that was fun to do. And Bob McDill was the writer on that song. And as you know, you know, this guy's written a ton of other things, man. He was, but thankfully they had held off on pitching it to anyone else, you know, until I got Mel to agree to do it.
Yeah, I'll bet you he got to liking it after it came out, didn't he?
we never talked about the hesitancy in any way at all. It was never brought up.
Down on the corner by the traffic light, Everybody's is looking as she goes by. They turn their heads and they watch her till she's gone. Lord have mercy, baby's got her blue jeans on. Up by the bus stop and across the street, open up their windows to take a peek. While she goes walking, rocking like a rolling stone. Heaven help us, baby's got her blue jeans on. She can't help it if she's made that way. She's not to blame if they look her way. She ain't really trying to cause a scene. It just comes naturally. Now the girl can't help it. Well, up on Main Street, by the taxi stand, there's a crowd of people and a traffic jam. She don't look back, she ain't doing nothing wrong. Lord have mercy, baby's got her blue jeans on. Not to blame if they look her way. She ain't really trying to cause a scene. It just comes naturally. No, the girl can't help it. Down on the corner by the traffic light, everybody's looking as she goes by. They turn their heads and they watch her till she's gone. Lord have mercy, baby's got her blue jeans on. Heaven help us, baby's got her blue jeans on.
So when did you decide to basically retire and get out of the business, Jerry?
One day, and this is something that not a lot of people know about, Scott, but I was in the studio. I was in the control room. I had always had this passion, man. I mean, I could not wait to get to the studio or the office or whatever. I always said I never worked, that I was always, God got up and went to fun. And it was that way with me from the minute that we got here into Nashville, whether I was sitting out in the room full of speakers playing or, you know, looking for songs or playing, you know, even, I wore three or four different hats at different times, but running the label was the lowest on my, you know, want to keep doing lists. But that even was fun because I could make a lot of decisions. Mercury let me have, you know, they never questioned anything I did. And that was a beautiful way to work with somebody for 22 years. But anyway, I was sitting in the control room, and I realized that I was not having the fun that I had been having, and I was with brothers. And when we were walking out, leaving the studio that day, I remember Don Harrell, and I can't remember if Jimmy was with us or not, but it was Don Harrell and Phil. And I said, guys, this may be the last thing I do. And they said they were, as it started the whole conversation about, they were going to be winded down too. And but anyway, that was the start of it, Scott. I just, it was not that fire, you know, like it had been.
Sure.
That was not fair to any artist I would be working with, whether I was playing or producing. It would not be fair to anyone to you know, be in charge of something and taking money for something that I didn't believe in.
I was very surprised when the Statler brothers retired. I was just amazed at that, but they went out on a high note, I guess, you know.
They did, and o'clock, and that was the best time. And as it turned out, I'm glad that Harold got to have the kind of life that he did up, you know, between the time they quit and the time that he was called home.
Well, Jerry, again, I just can't thank you enough for taking the time to talk with me. It is truly an honor for me. You just don't know how much I appreciate you taking time to be on My Kind of Country. Thank you so much, not only for your contributions to country music, but thank you for sharing it with my listeners tonight.
Scott, I feel honored that somebody wants to hear it, man, and I really appreciate you including me in on your interviewing, and that you feel like I've maybe did a little contributing here. And man, I had so much fun doing whatever it was that y'all liked. So that was so great.
Well, he couldn't do it any better. That's for sure. Well, Jerry, thank you so much, and we're gonna play more great music. That Jerry Kennedy produced and played on. Just a lot of fantastic country music coming up for you as we continue with My Kind of Country.
That's great. Thanks, Scott. I enjoyed it.
Thank you, Jerry.